It really concerns me because they're talking about banning a procedure that actually helps, is a great help to sexual minority persons. Parents who are told you can't let your children go to this SOCE therapy, or you have to undergo this these hormonal treatments for a transgender child, or else they're going to be much more likely to commit suicide, are being told not only something that's untrue, but is the exact opposite of the truth. In fact, preventing them from SOCE therapy or forcing them into some sort of puberty blocker hormone treatments is much more likely to produce suicide than the opposite actions.
Hello and welcome to the Dr. J Show. I'm Father Mark Hodges. I'm an Orthodox priest, and I'm delighted and honored to be sitting in for Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, founder and president of the Ruth Institute. Dr. Morse, we would solicit your prayers for. She is in the middle of flood repair all throughout her home. And this coming right on the heels of Hurricane Laura last year and a second hurricane that came through last year through Lake Charles, Louisiana. So if you think of Dr. Morse, if you think of the Ruth Institute or any of our work here at the Ruth Institute, please offer a prayer for her. Our guest today is Reverend Paul Sullins. Father Paul Sullins is a researcher and a sociologist and a Catholic priest. We're honored to have him here with us. He is a strong Christian man of high principles, and he brings to the table a science that is so neglected and so unknown. And we want to bring it to you here at the Ruth Institute. Father Paul, thank you so much for being a part of the Dr. J Show.
I'm very pleased to be with you today, Father Mark. And I'm also thinking of Jennifer, Dr. Morse. She is literally flooded and swamped, so we really lift her up.
Would you mind, I was going to start us with a brief prayer. Would you mind praying not only for Dr. Morse, but also for our interview today?
Yeah, absolutely. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, we turn our hearts to you, Lord, and we invite your presence to be with us this afternoon as we talk about issues that are important to the gospel and important to the happiness of persons' lives in many ways. Give us a ready facility of expression, ready recall, and I ask you to bless everyone who is listening to this discussion today, that you would open their minds to see and understand new things, whether it's what we're talking about or something else, and that you would bless them. We ask these things in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. Thank you very much, Father Paul. I would like to just reintroduce for those who watch this show and have not heard of you, Father Paul, I would like you to just share a little bit about yourself. Where are you coming from? And you're a Catholic priest, and yet I hear you're married.
This yes, that's right. Where else in the world are we going to have two married priests?
I'm teasing you, Father. You know that Orthodox priests are married.
Yes, of course, I know that.
Married, so I'm just teasing you, but go ahead, please.
Yes, I know. Well, maybe the church has learned a little bit from the Orthodox faith, at least in my instance. Probably not, but I became Catholic in 1998. I was a professor at Catholic University, was received a few years later into the Catholic Church and reordained as a Catholic priest. I'm married. I have three children, and I'm very happy to be kind of part of the this wonderful. I don't want to be too exclusive here, but I'm very happy to be on the bark of Peter, finding my way to heaven. That way. If anyone here listening is interested in the phenomenon of married Catholic priests, I have written a book on that topic. You're welcome to look it up. It's on Amazon. It's called Keeping the Vow, The Untold Story of Married Catholic Priests. and it's Oxford University Press, I think 2015. I would recommend if you have an interest to go ahead and get that book. It'll tell you everything you wanted to know about married Catholic priests and probably lots more besides. So anyway.
What faith background did you come from to the Catholic?
I grew up as an evangelical Protestant in Presbyterian and Methodist and Baptist churches of various sorts. My father was a Baptist minister.
Baptist, Southern Baptist?
I was Southern Baptist minister. It's an interesting fact, and if you read my book, I talk about this, that most of the Episcopal priests who converted to the Catholic faith first converted to the Episcopalian faith from a more conservative Protestant denomination. So I call us serial converts.
My father was a Southern Baptist minister as well. Went to Southern Baptist Seminary in Louisville, Kentucky. Then went to the American Baptist. But so you have your wife and you have three children. How old are they? Are there any grandsons on the horizon?
We have two grandchildren. The younger two are not married yet. They haven't reproduced, haven't obeyed that biblical command as of yet.
Be fruitful and multiply.
Yes, absolutely. And in a way that's pertinent to what we're going to be talking about today, isn't it?
Yes, it is, as a matter of fact. Father Paul, you are a sociologist by trade, is that right?
Well, I taught in the Department of Sociology. I don't like to identify myself as a sociologist, but I did teach sociology, and I have a PhD in sociology. Really my interests and activities have been not so much confined to the field of sociology. So I would more identify as a social scientist, looking at things more generally. Now, in the studies that we're going to be talking about,
what is the difference between a sociologist and a social scientist?
Well, social science encompasses psychology, political science, anthropology, sociology, and probably several other fields that I could mention that don't come to mind. So it's a broader perspective. On that particular area of intellectual inquiry, sociology concentrates on the behavior of persons in the aggregate, in groups.
You are on staff with the Ruth Institute, and as a researcher into so many effects of the sexual revolution, your work is invaluable to us. And you have been recently, as I understand it, involved in several significant studies that impact the Ruth Institute's sort of sphere of education and interest. I just wanted to begin and kind of set it up. We'll be talking about SOCE, Sexual Orientation Change Efforts. This is an umbrella term, as I understand it. You're the man. I'm a layman here, Father. But Sexual Orientation Change Efforts is an umbrella term encompassing any efforts to change unwanted same-sex attraction. And years ago, it would be called reparative therapy because so often it's almost a universal. There's some form of trauma in the background of those who are victims of same-sex attraction, childhood trauma or any kind of trauma. Also used to be called conversion therapy. And it's controversial because there are bans all over the United States against this. And even President Biden has called it trauma inducing and very negative, very harmful, very wrong. And he wants to pass legislation to ban it federally. So SOCE, Sexual Orientation Change Efforts, is what we'll be talking about. And I just wanted to share my own experience. My very best friend in high school died of AIDS. He turned away from Christ and became a militant homosexual. And he was a Madison Avenue marketing man. If you've ever seen Joan London Vaseline intensive care commercials, he's the one who did them, or Sony Betamax commercials. Anyway, But his roommate, who actually, as it turns out, gave him AIDS, I visited the two of them a few times. And once I visited them in their Manhattan apartment. And the very first thing that his roommate said to me was, I had a father who abandoned me. Out of the blue, I had never met this young man. And I have actually found that to happen more than once. Sensing they want to open up. And if they struggle with same-sex attraction, more often than not, I find them explaining or trying to explain to themselves the trauma that brought them where they're at. Mm-hmm. So with that kind of a teaser introduction, I would like to point it to you. Father Paul, what is the research you're doing and why is it so significant to sexual orientation change efforts?
There are two things that most scholars in the popular media will tell you about homosexual persons, which are untrue. The first thing that they'll tell you is that they cannot change their sexual orientation. Mm. Now, if you press them, they will admit that probably females can change their sexual orientation, but males cannot. And that's, if they know a little bit about the research, they'll qualify it a bit, but the first thing they'll say is it's impossible. It's any attempt to change someone's sexual orientation is ineffective and only leads to someone suppressing who they really are and trying to live a lie. The second thing they'll tell you is that persons who have undergone therapies or experiences to change their sexual orientation suffer great trauma and distress as a result of going through that experience. That's a stressful, stigmatizing experience. Often they undergo torture or some kind of mistreatment, and they come out with a range of negative psychological conditions. Most, but particularly, they come out suicidal, with very much higher rates of suicide for persons who have undergone this terrible, awful, intrusive therapy. In the studies that I'm kind of countering, they use pejorative language for this therapy. You mentioned one of those pejorative labels, which is conversion therapy, where the idea is you're trying to rip somebody out of a particular point of view and put them into another point of view. It might imply that they're focused on changing someone's sexual orientation, when in fact, if you talk to people who actually do this therapy, what they really are doing is trauma therapy in the manner that you've described. They're helping people to revisit or find some healing for their early life traumas, by and large, or a particular trauma that they're feeling now, they have PTSD kind of trauma. And in that therapy, they're open to someone talking about their sexual orientation, and they're open for that to change if that happens and if the person finds that to be a positive goal of the therapy. They don't impose those changes on people.
Father, would you go so far as to say they consciously look for the root, what we might say root causes of their unwanted same-sex attraction?
I don't even think they do that in this particular kind of therapy.
Okay.
So they prefer the term change-allowing therapy. And the distinction is between therapists who will allow someone to talk about their sexual orientation and to change that, and therapists who are from the secular mindset who say, we can't talk about that. We do what we call gay affirming therapy. But gay affirming therapy is kind of a little weasel language. They not only affirm the therapy, they won't affirm any alternative to being gay.
Right.
So it's like gay coercive therapy in my mind. If you say that you're gay, it's off the table to think that you might want to be something else or try to be something else. And the distinction then is between the therapists who will allow the client to define their own goals and pursue them. If they find that those same-sex attractions are disturbing and unwanted to them, then they can pursue that. into therapy. Whereas the therapist would say, well, if your same-sex attractions are unwanted or disturbing to you, then there's something wrong with you. You haven't accepted who you really are, and you need to, you know, get with the program for that. So those are the really is the distinction there. And you can see that already that we're talking about two fundamental views of a person and how they are related to their same-sex attractions. Now, in fact, it's not at all uncommon for persons to change their sexual orientation. If you study population data and you look at the percentage of men who have sex only with men and or identify themselves as homosexual at age 18 to 20, and then you look at that same population at age 35 to 37, you're going to find a much lower rate of persons who are engaged in persistent homosexual behavior at an older age than at a younger age.
Is that right?
But yeah.
I thought it was pretty much an established fact, at least the mainstream media considers it an established fact, that once homosexual, always homosexual, and cannot change. But if a significantly lower percentage, 20 years or 15 years later, are no longer practicing homosexuals, then that pretty much disproves it, wouldn't it?
Yes. A lot of homosexuality or homosexual behavior among young people is a kind of experimentation. It's an exploration of alternative sexual identities. And a lot of folk change their sexual orientation or go through some kind of remission later on in their lives. 10 years later, this guy has gotten married to a woman and he's in a marriage, and he may still have trouble with same-sex attractions. He may still engage in homosexual relation or not. Most of the time, not. And so he's settled down, you might say, into the more conventional heterosexual mold. That happens a lot. It's not tracked. It's not politically correct to track it. But if you look at the data, it's a lot. So there is a lot of defection that happens naturally. Now, we know this very well for women because there are some great books and studies by the psychologist Lisa Diamond. I'm looking at one right now on my shelf. It's called Sexual Fluidity. And that's the experience of women. Now, she, of course, is only studying and talking about lesbians, but it's not uncommon. And she would say it's quite normal for lesbians to experiment or have a period of time in which they have sex only with a woman or other women, and then they can change and be bisexual or have sex with men and enter into long-term relationships with men. Among women, it's not controversial at all that the people can change their sexual orientation. And so one of the difficulties with these studies is that they challenge the narrative that, as you've mentioned, that gay persons are born that way, that it's an innate, compelled condition, and they're unable to change. Let me just mention what these studies are. The first one is called Efficacy and Risk of Sexual Orientation Change Efforts. And it was just published in March, a couple of months ago. And in this study, by which I collaborate with two other authors, we looked at 125 men who reported that they had undergone sexual orientation change efforts. These 125 men report high rates of change in their sexual orientation. We measure sexual orientation on three dimensions. A person's attraction is who they want to have sex with. And so if it's someone of the same sex, say, okay, you're same sex attracted, or you're homosexual in your attractions. And we measure that by the well-known Kinsey scale, which goes from 1 to 7, seven being more homosexual and 1 being more heterosexual. These men on average reported a change from 5.7 on the Kinsey scale before they went through SOCE. So they were almost completely homosexual, down to 4.1 on average after the SOCE therapy. So most of them experienced some incremental change. They became less homosexual and more heterosexual in their attractions.
Now, are you talking about behavior or are you talking about internal struggles and attractions?
Right now, I'm talking about attractions. I will talk about behavior in a minute. So I'm talking about the first of those three dimensions, which is attraction. 14% of them experienced a complete change from homosexual to heterosexual in their attractions. The second way to measure homosexuality is our identification. What do you call yourself? A little less than half of them stopped calling themselves homosexual and started calling themselves either bisexual or heterosexual. Only 14% moved from calling themselves definitively homosexual to calling themselves definitively heterosexual. And then the third dimension would be their behavior. It would be who a person actually has sex with. And there was a little bit greater success. Again, it was about half who had some diminution of same-sex sexual activity, but about a quarter of the men experienced complete ceasing of any homosexual activity. And following their therapy experience, either practiced chastity, as we would call it, or were in a heterosexual marriage. So our conclusions are modest. We say some people can change their sexual orientation, and a lot of people can experience modest incremental change. So it's not that everyone can easily change their sexual orientation, but it's also true that some people definitely can change their sexual orientation. So two things are false. One is that, it's just a choice and you can easily make another choice. That's not true. The other thing that's false is that they can never, ever change. That's also not true. And it's that second one that is very, very problematic. It's because of that second one that some of the secular literature has described this study as being incendiary. And a previous version of this study was in fact retracted because it directly counters the prevailing idea that somehow people with a non-heterosexual sexual orientation can't change. The point of this study is just to open up the ideas that it's someone who experiences same-sex attraction, it is possible for that person to change. And they should be permitted to attempt to change if they want. Banning therapy for unwanted sexual feelings of any sort is an unjustifiable limitation of human freedom, of democratic freedom. The idea that somebody is stuck and can't change is simply false.
I have a side question, if I may insert it here. My experience as a priest hearing confessions, and actually since I got on Facebook several years ago, 15 years ago, 10 years ago.
God bless you. People, I never go on Facebook.
I was right. Got me in trouble more than once. Anyway, yes. I have been surprised, probably because of my naivete, how many married men,
right,
struggle,
yes,
with same-sex attractions, and they, right, they struggle and they act out on it, and then they come home in shame and so forth, kind of a cycle.
Yes.
And it surprises me how many married men who, of course, present themselves as heterosexual and so forth, mm-hmm, are actually struggling with this. And
yes,
I'm sure you've heard many confessions. I'm sure you're aware this is a phenomenon. Am I naive and this has always been this prevalent? I mean, it's kind of surprisingly frequent.
It's interesting that you would raise that point for several reasons. First, to address your question directly, I would say that it's pretty much always been this way. Remember, in ancient Greece and Rome,
Yes.
It was the kind of normal mode of maturing for a young man to connect up with an older man as lovers. If you read Plato and the dialogues of Plato and some of the discussions of Socrates, they talk about this openly, about the attraction of young male bodies to older men. It was usually an older, younger pairing. And that would be an accepted practice. But at a certain point, the young man would then turn away from homosexual activity, by and large, and would get married to a woman, because that was the expectation and the way to live in that society. And in fact, you could argue it has to be the way in any society if that society is to reproduce and continue. So the homosexual activity coexisted with a convention of marriage, even in ancient times. In the present day, there is also a coexistence of that. There is a large prevalence, relatively large prevalence, of men who are in heterosexual marriages. I would say many of them in fruitful, successful, happy heterosexual marriages, who also engage in homosexual liaisons at times. The classic model back through the middle of the 20th century was the bathhouse culture, where a man would be married and then he would sneak out on the weekends to bathhouses, places where homosexual men would meet in public facilities of some sort. And he would have some homosexual experiences and then would, you know, try to deny or live as if that didn't happen and go back to his heterosexual marriage.
You mentioned pederasty, the ancient practice of pederasty.
Yep.
And is it true to say that a large number, if not a majority, of practicing homosexuals had at some point in time, as a minor, an experience similar to that? In other words, the way I would put it is they were raped by an older adult male, and then they eroticized that and concluded in some way. Is that true? Is that unfair? Is that overly generalizing?
We don't know. We just don't have any data on kind of the etiology of how people develop homosexual. No doubt, there is a certain amount of recruitment of people into that community. There's the phenomenon of coming out, of expressing themselves, and when you come out, it's not only that you reveal yourself to your family and friends, but you also become part of a community of persons who have made that assertion. You know, it's like a religious testimony. You make that testimony and it binds you to the group. So there are those dynamics, but I have no idea about whether there's a kind of a pederasty or an older, younger dynamic that is common among persons who engage in homosexual behavior. Many people have the idea that homosexual attraction and heterosexual attraction are mutually exclusive, that you're attracted either to the one or the other. And in fact, the objection to persons changing their sexual orientation is that by doing so, they're somehow denying who they're truly attracted to be attracted to someone else. But the truth is that even the American Psychological Association has acknowledged that the Kinsey scale, which measures, you know, if you're more homosexual, you're less heterosexual and vice versa, measures them on a spectrum, is inaccurate, is false. The more accurate scale, and something that's called the Klein grid, measures homosexual attraction and heterosexual attraction separately, and allows the possibility that somebody might have high levels of both of them. And you know what? When you do that, most people who claim one can also claim another. But most people who have high homosexual attraction also have high heterosexual attraction. Now, don't misunderstand me. It doesn't mean that most people who have high heterosexual attraction also have high homosexual attraction. That's only 1 or 2%. But all of those on the other end who say, well, I'm attracted to men, or I'm attracted to persons of the same sex, say, well, are you also attracted to persons of the opposite sex? Well, yeah. Yes, I could have sex with a woman if I want to.
It's interesting, Father, you would mention the Kinsey Report. I have read somewhere, show it reveals my ignorance, but I have read the Kinsey Report, and inaccurate because of the selection of inmates right. that he used and so forth, and really seemed to have an ulterior motive of introducing rather perverse practices and pretending like they're very common popular practices.
Right, right. Yeah, the data from the Kinsey Report have been disproven by subsequent research, which is much more precise. From the Kinsey Report, you got the idea that a large proportion of American men engaged in homosexual activity. In 1994, there was the first really good population referenced study of how many men actually engaged in homosexual behavior or identified in any way as homosexual. And it was about 1.8% by the most generous measure.
1.8%.
1.8%. So we could say somewhere under 2% of men actually engage persistently in homosexual behavior, far fewer than in the Kinsey Report. But using the Kinsey scale doesn't necessarily mean a confirmation of the percentages reported in the Kinsey reports.
Father Paul, the common understanding is that gays are born that way. That's just the popular phrase. There's even popular music referring to being born that way. And yet studies have shown identical twins disproving this. Is it accurate to say?
The best evidence we have actually goes beyond twin studies nowadays, although it confirms the findings of twin studies. 2 years ago, in August 2019, it was published the first ever genome-wide association study of persons with same-sex orientation. It's called a GWAS, GWAS study. And what it does is it compares the actual sequenced genetic makeup of persons with one condition to the general population and finds out if there's enough of a difference to say that the persons who have this particular condition can attribute it to genetic differences. And what this study found definitively was that there was no genetic difference that could be seen between persons who had non-heterosexual orientations and the general population. And so the conclusion of that study, and if you look it up, it's even in the headline of the New York Times talking about the study, is that there is no gay gene. And in fact, the study concluded that it would be impossible for anyone ever to find a gay gene. This was a definitive kind of a study. And so that confirmed the general findings of twin studies. The idea that someone is born that way and can't change is just false. It doesn't conform to what we know about populations. It doesn't conform to what we know about genes. It doesn't conform to what we know about the experience of people who attempt changes and come out with positive life outcomes. And I could go on. We know today that the genetic composition of homosexual persons is pretty much indistinguishable from the genetic composition of anyone else. which tells us that no one is compelled by their innate genetic makeup to be exclusively homosexual or only homosexual. We've talked earlier about the fact that there's a large defection from homosexual activity in the population. I'm presenting to you some findings on men who have made efforts and succeeded, some of them, to change their sexual orientation. So, you know, we don't want to say that homosexuality is innately or genetically compelled. That's false. If you're going to talk about it in terms of in religious terms, in terms of the faith, the closest analogy would be the idea of a bondage, that persons believe something that's untrue, that they're bound up in a false idea, false feelings, and it's very hard to break that bondage. And I think bondage is a good image because in our study, as in almost every study of persons who have succeeded in changing sexual orientation, those who have very strong religious commitment are much more successful and much higher rate of success. And so if you are in a strong relationship with Jesus Christ, or if you're committed to follow the teachings of the Bible or of the Mormon faith, there are a lot of Mormons who have been successful in this. Any of those kinds of expression that put us in touch with our natural self as human yeah. beings, made in the image of God, to be resurrected in the person of Christ, it is something that makes it more possible for someone to change. And so that's the idea of a bondage. Another thing that makes it more possible for someone to change is just if they're married. In our study, the men who were married were much more successful at changing and resolving their unwanted same-sex attractions.
Right? That makes sense. Yeah.
Yeah. You could say just for kind of obvious reasons to not threaten that relationship and to be able to be a good father to their children. There was some strong motivation there.
Well, isn't it true, Father, that a great deal of the underlying yearning and longing for many, you know, we can't make a general rule for everyone, but many who struggle with same-sex attraction, but the foundation is very good and very right. The need for brotherhood, for companionship, for same-sex bonding and friendship. And, you know, as iron sharpens iron, so one man sharpens another. And right. It becomes eroticized. Is that correct or incorrect?
That's a very important aspect of being a man. It is very difficult to find healthy, socially approved male friendship today. You know, you have it in military settings and in sports settings, but it's not something that is as common as it should be. Young men particularly struggle with how to achieve masculinity, how to grow up male and to understand that. The church, particularly the Catholic Church, I think, does a good job of presenting men some options in that, but it is part of the struggle. I think that if a young man might find that kind of camaraderie in a homosexual relationship, I don't really know, but it's possible. It's good that you mentioned this though, because the other thing that's not true that's said about attempts to change sexual orientation, as I mentioned, is that it does harm, psychological harm to persons. And this was really the focus of the second study I want to talk about. But even in this first study, the one that surveyed these 125 men who had undergone SOCE therapy, we asked them about their psychological states before and after the therapy on 7 psychological domains, like depression, substance abuse, anxiety, and other domains like that, including suicide. Suicidality, we should say. And what we found is that most of them, almost all of them, experienced a positive psychological benefit from undergoing the therapy. They were in a better psychological state following the therapy than before it. Now, not all of them. 5% reported a negative psychological change, 95% a positive psychological change. Now, one of the differences between our study and almost every other study from the other side is that we studied persons who no longer identified as homosexual. They'd been through SOCE therapy, and now they said, well, I'm not homosexual anymore, I'm heterosexual. It's like the book, I no longer call myself gay, right? They didn't identify anymore as being gay. Almost every other study from the other side that wants to push a kind of homosexual agenda only includes persons who currently identify as gay. Now, if you think about it, you're trying to evaluate the effectiveness of a therapy that will allow people, is open to persons changing their sexual orientation, but you're only interviewing the ones who failed, who did not change their sexual orientation. And so you're, in a way, you're grasping at that small percentage who may have had a negative experience and may not have been successful. It would be like trying to evaluate the effectiveness of marriage therapy by only interviewing people who subsequently got divorced. Say, well, now how effective is marriage therapy? Everybody gets divorced, and you would conclude, well, it's never effective. We should ban marriage therapy. It does more harm than good. So one of the problems in the research in this area is that persons have not looked at a diverse population of formerly homosexual persons. And so they come to these negative conclusions unjustifiably. And we argue for research that looks at persons in both states, persons who identify now as heterosexual, even though formerly homosexual. The other study that I looked at pushed back or rebutted a study that came out last summer that looked at good population data on sexual minority persons and asked two questions. Have you ever been to SOCE therapy? And have you ever thought about suicide or expressed suicidality? And they found that persons who had ever been to SOCE expressed higher rates of all of these suicidal behaviors. And so they concluded that persons who were exposed to SOCE therapy must be more suicidal. Now, what's wrong with that conclusion? The thing that's wrong with it is that they may have expressed their thoughts of suicide before they went to SOCE.
Right.
So it's really only fair to look at the thoughts of suicide that somebody expresses after going to SOCE.
It's unfair for them to conclude that SOCE, sexual orientation change efforts, causes suicidal thoughts. They haven't led to that conclusion at all. The evidence doesn't lead there. This second study is very significant for not only same-sex attracted sufferers, but also for transgenders as well.
Right.
We have interviewed, you know, parents who have been told you need to allow sex change operation, or you need to allow puberty blockers, or you need to allow opposite sex hormones for your minor child, or else, which would you rather have, a dead daughter or a live son?
Kind right.
of idea.
And those are scare tactics. They're based on, if the reasoning of this study is accurate, they're based on a gross falsehood. Because, you know, if you have a cause and effect, the cause has to precede the effect, within the sense Aristotle, right? It has to come before the thing that it's supposed to cause. But in this kind of study, they just lump together lifetime suicidality and ever going to SOCE and say, look, the SOCE must have caused these things. When I wrote this study at first, I thought that this was so absurd and illogical, they must just not have thought about it. It must be unintentional. But I participated in a letter to the editor that pointed out the problem in this thinking. And they said, well, it really doesn't matter if undergoing SOCE is associated in any way with higher suicidality, then it must be a terrible, insidious kind of activity that we should ban and outlaw. Either don't get it, or have forgotten how to think logically, or they just really believe that thinking logically doesn't apply. They don't understand that not controlling for suicidality before SOCE doesn't just weaken or present an alternate view to theirs, it actually logically undermines their findings at all. So what I did
it's impossible to prove cause and effect if they're going to run a study that way without controlling for.
So in this second study, I corrected that error and I controlled for the suicidal expressions before SOCE. Now, before I controlled for them, I looked at how much of the suicidal expressions actually occurred before SOCE. And for suicidal thoughts, 2/3 of the suicidal thoughts that people had, they had before they went to SOCE therapy. For the other measures of suicidality, half of them occurred before going to SOCE therapy. So controlling for those, I found that persons who, after going to SOCE therapy, persons were much less likely to engage in any kind of suicidal behavior. We talked about there being a progression in these efforts. So persons who expressed thoughts of suicide and then went to SOCE therapy were 90% less likely to follow it up by attempting suicide than persons who expressed thoughts of suicide and didn't go to SOCE therapy. So going to SOCE had an enormously beneficial effect on someone's propensity to attempt suicide. And it really concerns me because they're talking about banning a procedure that actually helps, is a great help to sexual minority persons to prevent suicide. I also looked at another study that the data had not actually been analyzed that presented measures of the rates of suicide before and after SOCE. And in that study, it was a reduction of 88%. So I found about 90%, another study, 88% of the persons who had undergone SOCE were about 90% less likely to commit suicide. Now, let's think about that. They say, let's ban this because people who go to SOCE therapy have more suicidality, but ignore the fact that going to the SOCE helps them with their suicidality. What I argue in the study is that imagine a study of antidepressants and that says, look, almost everybody who takes antidepressants reports also having depressive symptoms at some time in their life. We should ban antidepressants. And so it will prevent all these depressive symptoms. It would, that absurd logic would lead to all kinds of trouble for people in depression. It would be the exact opposite of what you would want to have happen. But that's the logic that these scholars, so-called, are following. In fact, it's not only false, it's the exact opposite of the truth.
So this second study, this highly significant study, actually found that sexual orientation change efforts reduce suicidal tendencies.
Yes, I found a 90% reduction in progression to suicide following thoughts of suicide, depending on whether the person had been to SOCE or had not undergone any kind of SOCE therapy. And other studies have found very similar results to that. So parents who are told you can't let your children go to this SOCE therapy or you have to undergo these hormonal treatments for a transgender child or else they're going to be much more likely to commit suicide are being told not only something that's untrue, but is the exact opposite of the truth. In fact, preventing them from SOCE therapy or forcing them into some sort of puberty blocker hormone treatments is much more likely to produce suicide than the opposite actions.
I want to ask you why you do this, what you hope to accomplish by this, who you hope to help. I mean,
you know, you ask me why I do this. I do this because the so-called sexual revolution presents itself and furthers itself by presenting a series of untruths to people, claiming things that just are not true, but are widely believed to be true. The sexual revolution says that if you have sex with people that you're not married to, you have widespread sexual experience, that you'll be able to form a happier marriage and you'll have a more satisfying sex life. We know that's not true.
Right. Anyone who's married knows that's not true.
They say that if a woman is open to having sex with men, that she's going to be treated with more respect and is going to be more equal to men. But we know that's not true. Women hurt and suffer. They're kind of discarded and cast aside. We know that, now this may be too Catholic for you, but we know that we've been told that if women practice contraception on a general basis and therefore remove the prospect of childhood from sexual relations, that it's going to create a more free, open world. I grew up with that lie in the 60s. And everyone thought this was great free love, but we've learned that it's not free at all. It leads to lots of heartache. The people who engage in that kind of behavior without responsibility, really, end up, let's say, divorced from a marriage. Now, what happens there? A woman ends up 80% of the time or more with the children that from that relationship, which she then has to raise pretty much on her own. She buys herself terrible burdens, abandonment, the stress and strain of trying to put that life together. The single biggest predictor of poverty in America today is to be a single mother with children. 40% of such families are below the poverty line. It is not true that that leads to some wonderful bold new world. We were told that the children would adapt, that it would be better for children rather than to stay to be with parents who didn't want to be together. It would be better for the parents to split up and the children would turn out better. That turns out to be emphatically false. The biggest predictor of trauma for children, of all kinds of negative outcomes that follow them for their whole life, is that their parents split up. Half of children who are born into a marital relationship today are going to witness the breakup of that relationship before they turn 18. And in fact, 20% of that 50%, the half, are going to see the breakup of their parents' relationship at twice before they turn 18. So we have this pandemic, we might say, of divorce. You know, divorces decline, they say, but that's the divorce of first marriages. It's balanced by the rising divorce of second and subsequent marriages today. So we have this widespread divorce. We were told we had effective contraception followed by abortion, that there would be no unwanted children, that we would have end unwanted teen pregnancy. And the exact opposite happened. We had a spike of a terrible increase of teen pregnancy. And I could go on and on. But one of the lies that's presented is the idea that persons who are attracted to persons of the same sex are experiencing just a normal variant of the human condition, and that there is no particular problems or difficulties attendant with that, that it leads to a just relationship for all concerned. And that people are born that way and are expressing something that's part of their very makeup. That turns out not to be true either. It turns out that persons who are attracted to persons of the same sex are finding themselves. They're not abandoning themselves if they find their true sexuality, their true ability to relate in a way that can reproduce with someone of the opposite sex. The truth is that if you're attracted to someone of the same sex and you're uncomfortable with that, if you're disturbed by that, if that is troubling to you on moral grounds or on grounds of the quality of your relationship, you can change. You're not stuck. And that's the truth that we really need to communicate to people.
Very good. Thank you, Father Paul. We are coming towards the end of our time, but I'm glad you summarized that. Perhaps your most important words were the words you just spoke, because we conservatives, we Christians, Bible-believing folks, are so often slandered as haters.
Right.
The Ruth Institute was just written up as a hate group in two different articles just yesterday.
Yep.
And it's the opposite that is true. We oppose these things because they hurt people, because we care, because we love. That's why we oppose them, not because we're trying to oppress anyone or subjugate anyone or proselytize anyone. We want the good of every individual and of society. We want love to flourish. In fact, the Ruth Institute, one of our mottos is that we're building a civilization of love, that this is the direction we think society should go in, not these harmful, self-destructive ones.
Right.
So I'm so glad that you mentioned that. Father Paul, as we conclude, please let us know links and books. You've already mentioned one book, but anything that folks can read further, anything you want to share, anything, any way that they can contact you and ask questions?
They can send me an email. It's psullins@ruthinstitute.org. And if they want a copy of these studies, I'll send them that. I also have a review of the research in this area with a cloud folder to all of the studies. psullins@ruthinstitute.org, and I'll just shoot you back that research review and all of the studies. Thank
Very
you.
Very good. Very good. Well, thank you so much, Doctor, the Reverend Dr. Paul Sullins, for being our guest here on the Ruth Institute, the Dr. J Show.
Bye-bye. God bless you all.